CTV. Good morning. My advice to you in British Columbia's financial crisis at the moment is to forget all about the BCGEU settlement. That'll probably happen sometime today. To forget about all the other restraint programs of the government. To forget about the possibility of an election writ, which may or may not come. But to remember that the government plan is to cut arbitrarily $121 million from the public school system by the end of next year. It's no exaggeration to say, I believe, that the 75 school districts throughout the province of BC are in a state of flux and confusion because of the arbitrary edicts. This morning, you're going to meet a number of school trustees who've come to the studio to tell you what they hope to be able to do. Marjorie, Stewart of Nanaimo. Dr. Eric Buckley from Central Okanagan. Phillip Rankin, Vancouver School Board. Mark Sager, West Vancouver School Board. Louise Sorensen, Surrey, District 36. John Taylor, Coquitlam 43. Marion Williams, Powell River. And Gary Bejan, president of the BC School Trustees Association. One of the first stories we're going to look at this morning is whether or not old ad Hockery Vander Zalm has made some kind of special deal for the premiers, for the schools and the premiers riding in South Okanagan. We'll try and straighten this out and find out, if anybody can, what is going to happen to your schools, your school children, and your teachers, and your support staff, with these people who have to handle the Vander Zalm edict after the break. I'm on the phone. A little bit of background. A couple of weeks ago, I had Gary Bejan and Larry Keane and, of course, the Minister Vander Zalm, the new minister on the air, and he made a number of things perfectly clear. One, the cuts were coming. The cuts were here. And he conceded that there'd be $28 million on the first cut this year, another $37 million again by the end of this year for a total of $65 million. And next year, more for a total of $121 million. And he said, in effect, the school trustees, I don't care how you do it, but you will not interfere with the school year. We haven't looked at capital construction costs or anything like that. Just do it, and if you can't do it, I might have to consider stepping in and helping you. At that time, the teachers were predicting a layoff anything from 2,000 in September to 12,000 by the end of December of this year. Now, we're going to start with Gary Bejan, who speaks for all 75 school districts in British Columbia. Have you yet had any clear guideline instructions from Vander Zalm on how this was to be done to make him happy?
No, Jack. The only direction we've received from the minister is that the cuts are first of all to take place in the non-salaried items, and then the cuts are to take place in the salaried accounts. And that would allow us to either roll back, to get days off without pay, to make some kind of a deal. Failing to make a deal, it would require terminations to take place throughout British Columbia, and that alone, using the current legislation, is going to cause the chaos that we predict.
How many layoffs have been made throughout the school system in this particular state of flux at this particular state of time?
At the present time, we can't really put a number on it because of the fact that there are deals pending, and we were all required to file our reports last Wednesday. And for instance, in South Okanagan, they filed a report that said that instead of terminating 19 teachers, they would transfer money from their capital account over into their operating account. And that would, along with a surplus in the cash account, that would find them their shortfall. Now, we have heard the minister since then say that he will not allow transfer of capital into operating. But the ministry staff allowed that district to go ahead and write up that deal with their teachers.
Let's go to the Central Okanagan to Dr. Eric Buckley, one of the trustees. You are in a state of confusion now. You were quite prepared to make certain cuts in line with restraint. What were these cuts?
We were authorizing a voluntary payback of about $500,000 by our teachers against the minister's directive that we may do such a thing in part of the negotiations, but that we could not consider closing the schools, nor could we in any way give exemption of attendance of the teachers on the prescribed days in the school calendar. The teachers had rejected the deal on the basis that they insisted that for each of the paybacks that they make from their salary, they get equivalent time off without work. Our board was opposed to that. Our board did not have the authority to agree to that, and so we had no option but to issue termination notices to 102 teachers. Immediately thereafter, the minister on an open line radio program made a commitment that he would grant our board the authority to give up to 3.5 days time off in exchange for the salary rollbacks.
Does that save the jobs?
It would save the jobs. But it flies against the instructions that he gave us back in August that we may consider voluntary payback of salary on non-instructional days, but we were not allowed to consider closing the schools.
You were all set to make your deal to give 102 termination notices. The teachers would not attend on certain days and would not get paid.
They would not get paid, but our board insisted that they must work the prescribed number of days under the regulations.
And then Vander Zalm steps in on an open line show and says,
you can have the time off and also instruct the Kelowna School Board, which he did in a telex following the later that day.
Now what does that do? Is this general policy yet?
Well, at the present time, we understand it's just a deal with Kelowna. And of course, we're saying what's good for the Premier's riding and the Kelowna School Board, it's good for the rest of the province. Because out there already, there have been deals made. Teachers have given up days. They're at the present time are going to have to be in attendance if it's their non-instructional day. And now we've got one school district having special privileges, and the others have yet to receive that notice that it applies to them too.
I want to get this just once again, just exactly what ad hoc concession he has given this time so I can understand it. What is it he's done? Tell me once more.
He has accepted the Teachers Association's view that the only thing standing in the way of a deal in Kelowna was that our board didn't have authority to give time off. He did not consult with our board to verify that position. He did not consult with our board chairman or superintendent, and he accepted that view of the situation. In actual fact, our board had made it quite clear that in order for teachers to take some part in this restraint program, we would accept a payback equivalent to 3.5 days salary, but the teachers must agree to work all of the prescribed days. The minister interfered with our strategy without consulting with us and essentially sold out to the strategists of the BC Teachers Federation.
And double-crossed your deal.
Exactly.
You were prepared to get that $500,000 back, and you could have insisted on that, couldn't you?
We had agreement on the amount. It was simply a matter now of sorting out agreement on the teachers being committed to work those days.
Whether it was parent teacher days or professional development days, they would have what? And then Vander Zalm steps in and says they can have the time off.
Yes.
What does that do to your overall policy?
Well, what it does now is it means that we're now back to the bargaining table in many of the districts again, because I'm sure that if a deal was made, people are going to say, why should I now have to come and work? I want to have the same as Kelowna. I want to be able to be free that day and not have to show up. And many of the deals were made using the current law that's in place, and it's going to cause a problem there.
Now, just we'll leave that for the moment. We'll come back to that with the other teachers. But in the Central Okanagan, where you had a budget of, what, $45 million, and you had to cut 1.3 by the end of the year.
In addition to the 1.7 from last spring, yes.
So you had to cut $3 million.
Yes.
You had cut out a lot of stuff, though, hadn't you?
Yes, we had.
For instance?
We had eliminated almost all of the transportation for field trips. We had eliminated about 80% of our substitute teacher funding. We had eliminated transportation assistance to parents whose children live well beyond the end of the school bus
route. Or people who have to drive to the school bus system.
Yes.
That's gone.
Yes. We had totally eliminated the professional development fund in agreement with our teachers. They accepted that. We had cut back on curriculum development. We had virtually eliminated program evaluation. We had made very serious incursions into the program base for operating a school system. But we were still about $800,000 short.
And you'd eliminated all school aides?
All school aides.
And on the $800,000, you were planning to save you were going to get half a million payback with the teachers still attending school in line with the law. And Vander Zalm phones an open line show and says it's okay for Okanagan.
We hadn't yet concluded the deal, but our negotiations were still going on, and the final act was being played out in the issuing of termination notices.
What's happening is that the minister is now saying yes to what he has consistently said no to. He said on this show that he was not in favor of reducing the number of prescribed days. He said that if school boards were to go that route, it was a cop-out. Now school boards do have the authority, or at least Kelowna has the authority, to reduce its number of prescribed days by using non-instructional days. Therefore, if they wanted to, they could shut the system down for 5 days during the month of December prior to the Christmas break, and people would not have to be in attendance, they would not be paid, and the students would not be there.
Do you feel that's what it means to you?
We could apparently do that now, although we didn't realize that at the time we were negotiating with our teachers.
So that would have saved a lot of panic, and that will save your 500 of your 800,000 shot.
Yes, and the other 300 will come out of programs.
Any administrators laid off?
In fact, yes, but it was through a natural attrition, not through terminations.
And you've not given now termination notice to any teachers?
No, we felt we had no option. Once the minister made this deal on the radio line, we would have certainly been violating an implied ministerial directive by proceeding with any of the layoffs.
And so at the moment, unless it's become general policy, it's a special deal for the Premier's riding?
As far as we are aware at the present time.
And as far as I know, that it's only Kelowna that got the deal.
More with the school trustees, different school trustees, after the break. We've got to try and get hold of Vander Zalm to clear up this business about the professional development days. But now I have two locals, you might say. I have Phillip Rankin, a trustee of the Vancouver School Board, and Mark Sager, the chairman of West Vancouver School Board. Now, Phillip, you lost your court challenge. Some people said it was futile, that anything he was trying to do, he being Vander Zalm, was futile. You'll now agree with that, won't you?
Oh, I don't agree that the lawsuit was futile. I think that what it did was draw attention to what was going on in terms of education cutbacks, and it was one of the methods to bring it to the public's attention. Secondly, we had a good legal opinion that we had a good case, and thirdly, we have an opinion that we have a reasonable, appealable point. So,
how much did you have to cut by any specific date that we can work with at the moment?
December 31st, $4.5 million.
And March next year?
Well, they say that we have 12 million, but it's actually going to be 14 million.
What have you done to cut your expenditures?
Well, up to this point, we've had a hiring freeze in the district. We've had no expenses, in other words, no orders going through for library books. We've just sort of tell everyone to hang on until we see what the outcome of the case was. We're now in a position to, after going through all of the non-salary accounts and then the service accounts, to have to come up with another $2.5 million. That either means that we have a layoff of about 350 teachers and 150 other kinds of people. We get the same kind of deal that Kelowna has, and our teachers agree to it. That is, we get a 4-day shutdown, which would get us through till Christmas. Or we find $2.5 million in services, such as no repairs to the school, no materials for the school. And that's one of the recommendations we have, that we're going to have absolutely no purchases of materials between now and Christmas, and basically operate under a state of siege.
Are you planning to lay off any teachers at all?
At this point, we have a tentative proposal which would cost 350 teachers and 150 non-teaching staff. That doesn't mean we intend to. That's one of the alternatives if we can't get the professional days and if we can't find the money in the maintenance and materials budget. So we have a plan. It's not a plan that we want to deal with.
How much fat have you trimmed out of the other things? I know there's Okanagan, which is different, mind you, has cut out $500,000 in field trips.
We cut out $2.1 million in the spring, which was basically percentage cuts in every area of the school. Materials, budgets, field trips, paper, mailing, you name it, all the transportation services. So we've gone through a $2.1 million cutback.
So therefore, anything that you've done up to now hasn't actually affected classroom teaching?
It has, well, we have, you could say the non-substitute days, that was one of our proposals. Some people say that doesn't affect the classroom, but you have a core of 250 substitutes in Vancouver, that's what they rely on for their year's work, and that's where we select our future teachers. So when people say that they've cut out substitute time, what they're doing is there's 250 people or the equivalent in every district who are going to go without jobs. So there is teachers being cut silently, the non-permanent staff.
Has your PTR gone up yet, your pupil-teacher ratio?
Our pupil-teacher ratio is the same this year as it was last year.
Another question to you. Everybody believes, nobody quite knows for many years, that there's much feather-bedding in highly paid administrators. Are any of them being chopped?
We have three administration positions which are frozen right now, which haven't been filled. They're going to have to be filled because they're key positions. We have had, during the NPA years, there was some administration, people were removed, and our averages in terms of administrative to pupil cost is lower than the average for the province, mainly also because we have large schools, and so we can get that kind of efficiency because of the larger schools.
Mark Sager is chairman of West Vancouver School Board.
Good morning.
How are you, Mark?
24.
24. Youngest school board chairman in the country, probably.
I don't know.
Now, West Vancouver School Board has always been regarded as fat, sassy, feather-bedded, and full of the most senior teachers, right?
You're saying that, not me.
Well, I'm saying that. What's your budget?
What is our budget? It's, after this restraint, about $19.5 million.
How much have you cut?
We've cut $454,000.
What have been your principal cuts?
Principally, we've tried to affect all of the areas of with the exception of the teachers. We have cut from our repairs and maintenance account rather substantially. We've cut from the district office accounts, and we've cut from the school supplies accounts. And we had an estimated surplus, an estimated increase in revenue.
So you've also cut out 27 teacher aides.
Right.
Will they be a big loss? Were they not just a kind of expensive adjunct in a heavily teachered area like West Vancouver?
I don't know. They've been there a long time. We'll see.
They've gone.
What happens, yes.
Mm-hmm. Now, what about the professional days? Will this help you at all? This apparent new policy of Vander, Zalm that you can close the school for students for 5 days and you don't need to get a roll back from the teachers?
We don't need to close the schools for 5 days in West Vancouver. We went through and literally item by item, and you can have a look at it. We cut little bits here and there, and we can do it.
Maybe they should have been cut before. Maybe you were too.
Perhaps. The other districts that are saying, well, it can't be done and it's going to destroy education, I don't believe that. Because if we can find money in our budget, I'm sure they can in theirs.
Your pupil numbers dropping in West Van?
A little bit, yeah. We have a
decline. Are there any half-empty schools that should be closed?
Perhaps, yeah.
How many?
Maybe two.
When are you going to close them?
We'll be looking at it. We've just developed a long-range plan, which will come out and be a public document within the next couple of weeks.
Which two would these be that you might close?
Not going to say until that document's up.
Your pupils are dropping sharply in Vancouver, too, aren't they?
Our pupils, our amount of pupils have stayed pretty close to the same. We're down 1,000 out of a population of 53,000. We're down to about 52,000.
You don't feel the system's feather-bedded?
I don't feel us. I feel a system has got some excesses in certain areas, but I think it doesn't do the job. There should be more money spent in areas of special education, Native Indian education, handicap education, ESL education. So I think we're not spending enough money in certain areas.
How about counselors and French immersion and learning assistance? Is that being cut under your new program?
We've cut from instructional material, the district library, the culture and performing arts, outdoor education, in-service.
How about you? English as second language, is it going to be cut?
Yeah, it's 40% of our population are ESL children. We could cut it and send them all into the classroom, and they wouldn't understand what the teacher was saying, or would she understand what they're saying?
No, but I mean, you're not going to cut it.
Can't cut it.
You can't cut it.
Can't cut it. It's a basic. As far as Vancouver is concerned, it's a basic. And just this issue of basic education, the minister says we should go back to basics, but everybody that's out of work right now has got a basic education. It's those people that have fitted into the more unusual areas that are getting jobs, not people with basic education. They're a dime a dozen.
What do you think of Vander Zalm and his policies?
Vander Zalm's a good minister.
Doing his best.
He's doing his best. We're in a very difficult situation. And I think this attitude, which I'm hearing a little bit from you, Jack, is that it's an us and they situation. I don't think it is. I think it's all of us. And this system, it'll continue to work. We'll continue to provide a damn good education in British Columbia as long as the teachers and the parents and everyone want to cooperate.
What do you think of Vander?
I think he's the worst minister of education that we have ever had, and that's going some because we had McGeer before that. I don't have the same ambitions as Mr. Sager, perhaps, to be a minister of that particular government. And I think that to say that it is a them or us situation, because this restraint program could be achieved in the next fiscal year with less damage to the system right now. And really, he's playing the most sort of stupid kinds of politics.
Are you telling me that, one, you'd go along with the restraint, but given a year's planning, you could have achieved the object without disruption?
I think we would be able to plan restraint in a way which makes sense. I don't say that I would go along with it happily, but we would be able to do it without having major dislocations.
And you probably agree with that, too.
A little bit more time will help, but I mean, let's face it, we're in business, you're in a business here or wherever, and you can't plan for what's happened to the economy.
Okay, Van der Zandt's going to come up immediately after the break on one of our lines, and I'll two more trustees, and I'll bring Gary Bajan back as well. Right. Are you there, Bill?
Jack.
Can't hear you.
Hi, Jack. Can you hear me now?
No, speak up a little bit and turn up the volume at the same time.
Well, I'm speaking as loud as I can without...
That's fine. Bill, on the program... Oh, the Honourable Minister of Education, Bill Vander Zalm. On the program this morning, Dr. Eric Buckley from Okanagan School District 23 said that you just fouled up a deal he was making with the teachers by which they would roll back about $500,000 and take some time off.
No time off.
$500,000 and no time off. And you go on an open line show and give the teachers all they want, which is in direct reverse of what Buckley and the school trustees were planning on your vague instructions. What happened?
Well, what happened is that the only instruction submitted to us by Kelowna was that they were going to lay off 104 teachers.
102.
104 is the figure we've got.
Right.
Anyway, they were going to lay off that many teachers, and when I went on the program in Kelowna, the president of the Teachers Association was on the program, very upset about the proposed layoffs, and said there was no way out of it, and it was chaotic and all the rest. Mr. Buckley came on, or Dr. Buckley came on, and said, no way out of it. They had all these meetings, and there's nothing could be done. I said, did you talk about taking some of the professional days and suggesting to the teachers that they not be paid for those professional days? He said, can't be done, because the teachers insist that if that were to be agreed to, they would also want some agreement that those teachers who felt very badly about the principle of this could in fact stay home and not attend on the professional days.
But that's what you told us on the program, that you couldn't fiddle about the professional days.
So I'm sorry, I didn't get that, Jack.
That's what you said on the initial program, that the professional days had to stay.
No, the non-professional days, the instructional days, when the teacher is in the classroom with the kids, those days I didn't want to move on.
All right, let me ask Gary Bajan, what is the net effect now of this particular ruling in relation to the Okanagan?
Well, what's happened now, Mr. Minister, is that school districts that did get a deal with their teachers to use the non-instructional days, whereby the teachers would be there working on the non-instructional day, I'm quite sure that that's all gone by the board now, because in the other districts, people who got that kind of a deal are going to come forward and say, if Kelowna doesn't have to work, then we're not going to work either.
Well, when you talk, you see, the thing is, Kelowna was the biggest district, or the district with the greatest number of layoffs. And some districts have agreed or have negotiated with their teachers for professional days. There's nothing we can do to force a teacher to attend professional days anyway. We would hope, however, that their professionalism would certainly encourage them to attend.
Excuse me, Mr. Minister.
If they stay home, I can't be out there twisting their arms or pulling them off.
Yeah, but I want to get
professional day.
I want to get the principle clear here from Gary.
In your regulations that we have to abide by, you state the use of the non-instructional days. They can be used for parent-teacher conferencing. They can be used for fairs in a community. They can be used for a professional time outside of the school or professional time in the school. They must be times used that are approved by the school board. And you give a number of suggestions that they can be used for. Therefore, the teachers must be accountable for the use of their time.
Now, what's the new principle that involves now in the negotiations? That's what I want to get clear from Gary Bajan and view what the minister says.
As a result of the minister's action on Friday, school boards can now negotiate the use of the non-instructional time, and therefore the teachers do not have to be in attendance as had been the previous case.
And that will save money?
It will save money.
Why didn't you do it in the first place, Mr. Van der Zalm?
Well, because I was never asked if, in fact, we would make some provision that would permit a teacher to stay home on a professional day. All I was asked is to permit the school instructional days to be cut back. I said, no, we will not cut out by taking away the classroom time for the youngsters. They must have that classroom time.
And we got this clear now. The fact is that on these professional days, the teachers don't have to be there. Is that right?
According to the announcement of Friday, now I would think if the minister applies it to all 75 boards, teachers do not have to be in attendance on non-instructional days.
And they don't
days.
Have to be paid.
That's right.
Is that a deal?
Well, we were hoping that this would apply only to those districts who were not able to negotiate with the teachers that they be in attendance.
All
if
right,
being in attendance is a hang-up, we can work it out with the individual school districts. We'll certainly provide whatever the order required to permit this. Why complicate it? It doesn't have to be that difficult.
Mr.
They can find all the monies they need in those professional days. So all
no,
this talk
can't.
About cutting programs, about not having available instructors for the handicapped and the likes won't be necessary, because if the instructional days can be negotiated with the teachers, that's sufficient.
Oh, I thought it was a special deal for the Premier's riding.
No, it came from the Premier's riding because this is when I was first made aware of it. It's no special deal.
Okay, Mr. Buckley wants the last word, because he was the man whom you double-crossed.
The problem with the minister's statement is that by saying this deal was available only for districts who could not negotiate a full working deal, was that we were in the process of trying to do precisely that when he interfered.
You would have got the full working deal.
I believe we could have got the full working
but
deal.
But Van der Zalm succumbed to the local PCTF guy.
Yes, he did.
How's that, Willie? You plead guilty.
Listen, they had weeks to work at it, and it's strange that the only thing we had up until the day after or 2 days after
still
the submissions were
seven.
To be in, the only thing we had from Kelowna was 104 layoffs. Now, look, you know, if they're given the time, they've got to be in by a certain date, and they can do the job, don't fault me for resolving it on a hotline show. I don't care where it's resolved. A hotline show, my office, his office, who cares, as long as we don't have to lay off teachers.
Okay, well, we'll keep somebody listening this morning in case you want to make any other changes, because we're going to listen to a lot more school trustees.
Well, look, the situation is nowhere near as difficult as the newspapers and some other people attempt to make it out. They're just trying to make a big deal out of something that can be resolved relatively easy. And we'll work it out with the school trustees.
Okay, last word from Gary.
Mr. Minister, are you also going to allow South Okanagan to transfer capital monies over into operating, because that was the deal that they made with their teachers so that they would not be terminating any teachers up there, and that was with the blessing of your staff to go ahead and write that deal up and present it to you. Have you authorized that also?
No, I've not heard anything about anyone transferring capital into operating, and for that matter, capital expenditures are financed over a number of years and the savings would be minimal.
Well, I think that you should look at the South Okanagan proposal that they have submitted on the 15th, and it indicates what the deal is, and it went in there and was encouraged to be written up by your staff that way.
Well, at least we've got one thing clear, Bill. If you make any more changes, please call before the end of the program.
Okay.
Thanks, Bill Van der Zalm.
Bye-bye.
Take a break.
see it. It was too close.
It ain't easy to write real good, speak real good, and understand real good when Willie sets up a program, I'll tell you. Ain't easy, no how. Now I'd like to meet Marion Williams, who's the chairman of Powell River School Board, District 47, and Marjorie Stewart, who is the chairman of Nanaimo Ladysmith, number 68. Have you managed to meet Willie's deadlines? Well, Vanderzam's deadline. Shouldn't call him Willie.
We have met the minister's deadline because the local teachers association took matters into their own hands to help us find a solution for this problem and took 3 days of withdrawal of service, it was called.
And they went on strike for 3 days.
Withdrawal of service was their terminology for the action they took.
You mean they closed the classrooms for three days?
They closed. They didn't appear for 3 days.
So you didn't have to pay them?
That's right.
Now, that helps you in your cuts up until the end of the year, but how much would that save you, for instance?
That would save us about $150,000, which is less than half of what we have to restrain between now and December.
We have another $180,000 to go.
Which comes out of programming and other areas like that kinds of things. The other trustees have been talking about cutting things to the bone.
But specifically, what did you cut? Because in this time of crisis, it seems that there was lots of stuff available to be cut without necessarily affecting the standard of education.
Well, I suppose you say you cut back hydro and fuel. We have no heat in our schools for the next couple of months. We've cut that back so far that we really don't have any budget. We're going to have an overrun in that area. Is that a need? I don't know whether.
So it's going to be heavy coats in Powell River.
Well,
by the middle of November, anyway.
These are the kinds of cuts. You call that fat. I don't call heat in the school fat. We've cut cultural, we've cut all travel, all sports. We're a pretty isolated location, even though we aren't far from here, but we're very isolated.
Yeah.
And it eliminates all our sports trips because it costs money to go anywhere to play. That's important. We think it's important.
Sure it is. Teacher aides?
No, we haven't cut teachers' aides. The teachers are teachers' aides and teachers. All personnel in the district is going to be treated in a parallel fashion. In other words, if there's 3 days loss of pay for the teachers, there will be a similar thing for all QP people. We think the teachers' aides are really important, so we are trying to maintain the level, cut back as we can.
You're saying that you're going to, you will lay off the QP people for 3 days without pay.
They have, they were not at work for those days. The schools were shut down tight for those 3 days of withdrawal of service. So, in essence, they have lost 3 days' pay.
Now, how are you going to do the other 180,000 out of all your sports and your fuel hydro?
Out of cutting everything
cultural.
Else, libraries.
Okay,
and,
that's
and
for
so
this year.
That's
next
for this year.
How much do you have to cut?
It looks like about $840,000, depending on the enrollment on September 30th. It's based on the enrollment.
Is your enrollment going down or up?
Our enrollment's going down.
What would your pupil-teacher ratio be?
About 16.6 it was last year.
Could you do with fewer teachers if you had to? Obviously you could.
We will do with fewer teachers. It would appear that we are going to have to. We have lost 12 teachers already this from June to September. We have 12, 13 less teachers on staff beginning of September. We are reducing
by
our
attrition
teachers.
Is that
by attrition, early retirement incentive plans, things like that, to get some movement in our teaching force.
So far it hasn't affected the teaching standards in Powell River.
Not yet.
Marjorie Stewart was chairman of Nanaimo Ladysmith. Same problems, or have you got worse problems?
All the problems are different. We were cut $750,000 in May. We're short four administrative positions, two of which we've deleted, two of which are empty. We don't have a single person doing personnel for our 1,000 employees at present. We cut back to the provincial level in learning assistance, which is one teacher per 350 students. We had been running at one per 300. We've cut our gifted program. We cut our swim program long ago voluntarily because of restraint. We have another $1 million to find by December 31st. We know that we can find half of that in non-salary accounts. We know, and our teachers know, that the rest has to come out of salary accounts, about $750,000. We have an agreement with our teachers that we will continue in discussion with them until October 15th. After October 15th, all bets are off and the bottom line is unilateral terminations by the board. We're looking at about 50 or 60 teachers' jobs just to make it through to December 31st if we don't make the kind of deals that Mr. Vandersam's been making.
And that's very crisp and very clear. You've gone, your learning assistants, you've gone from one teacher for 300 and up to one to 350.
That's right.
You had one to 300.
That's right.
These are teachers who went around the classrooms and helped various children with problems.
That's right.
You've cut out your gifted program.
Gone.
You've cut out your swimming program before.
Long gone.
You've got no fat in your administration.
Well, I should tell you something about pupil-teacher ratio for our district. I don't know about the other districts. We have 13,000 students. We're up 200 this year, mostly in secondary. We have about 700 teachers. Our pupil-teacher ratio has gone up by half a point between May and as of this date because we laid off all the temporaries in May and our substitute list is now swollen with temporary teachers out of work. So nobody gets onto the substitute list. Added to which, 125 of those teachers are district staff delivering special programs in special education, mm-hmm. teacher librarians, music specialists, Native Indian education, alternative education for children who cannot sit in regular classrooms. So we're not talking about classroom size. We're talking about starting to look at those special programs which ameliorate the effect of a centralized provincial educational system.
Yeah, and help your general education standards. Now, what does that mean when you come to October 15 and have no deal with the teachers? Are these things going to be slashed? You
yes.
said 60 teachers.
Yes, we have to go partway into class size and partway into programs because those programs are 100% locally funded, Jack. That's the trick. We're going to be stripped. In Nanaimo, we had several very excellent educational programs for children and they're 100% locally funded. We're going to be gradually stripped of everything we invented to improve the system locally.
Because there's no provincial funding for it and your budget won't cover it in any way, shape or form. And your local funding will have to be used for other items.
Every single one of those special programs was begged, pleaded for, demanded by the community.
Down the tube?
Down the tube.
And you say 60 teachers before the end of the year?
That's right.
Now what about this new South Okanagan Vander Zalm Teachers Union deal? Would that save you some money?
That might do it. Our daily salary bill is $165,000. And we have the same agreement, nobody has any agreements with CUPE, they're just going to sit tight and see what we do. But if the teachers aren't there, and if the whole system is closed down, nobody else is working.
Now, what are these kind of days that they've done in Okanagan, I get mixed up in this?
Non-instructional.
Non-instructional day.
Teachers are supposed to work non-instructional days in some way specified in the minister's regulations.
So therefore, if you make the same deal they made in South Okanagan, you'll get 4 or 5 days at $100,000 a day, which you won't give out to teachers' salaries.
Or anybody's salaries, because our total salary account is 165 a day.
Another five of those days, Anna.
That would do it.
Well, if you'd done this across the province with every school board at the beginning of the program, you would have known where you stood, wouldn't you?
Isn't that what you usually do when you run out of money? You close down the operation
right.
for a period?
What do you think of Anna, Sam? I'm not asking your politics. Has this been a well handled by the ministry or badly handled?
The previous minister very often didn't give us answers to questions, and that was just as bad. Mr. Vandersam is giving us his personal answers. I'm really not interested in his personal opinions. I'm interested in what he's going to do in his job as Minister of Education, as educational policy for this province, and I really haven't heard anything about that yet.
You've got to be able to write good. How about you, Marion? What do you think of the way the government has handled this?
Mr. Vandersam spoke to us at a seminar in the late August, and he talked about getting back to common sense in the school system. If he had applied some of that common sense to the restraint that he is asking of school boards and that most school boards would like, realize that we need, there is a need for some restraint, but if he had used some common sense so that we could plan this, and have local districts. Mark Sager mentioned that all school districts could do this. Mark Sager doesn't know the situation in our school district or our budget. The difficulty is every school district has different problems and different areas where they can cut. If he had left us enough flexibility, given us the tools to do this, I think we all could have done it with the least amount of damage.
And less emotional trauma for all concerned.
A great deal less.
More trustees after the break. Well, we don't know if Vanderzam's policy is stable and fixed or whatnot, but we seem to have a better idea now that he's going to authorize school boards throughout the province to save the money by not paying the teachers who won't have to attend on the professional development days. Five of them. Five times 30,000 teachers a day's pay might help some school boards apart from the Premier's writing itself. Now to Louise Sorensen, who is chairman of one of the school boards that seems to make as much noise and its teachers as any in the province. Surrey School Board. You're pretty mad at Vanderzam, Louise Sorensen, I veritably believe.
Well, right now there are two major problems, Jack. First of all, I wish that we had known last week that the minister was going to do this. This morning, our superintendents are going around the district personally delivering termination notices to 90 temporary teachers. And we knew last week that the teachers, through their motion, had indicated that if we asked them, as we had, to give up 2 days without pay, that they wouldn't work those 2 days, so we could have achieved a solution. I've been trying to contact Mr. Vanderzam for several days last week and haven't been unable to talk to him.
Well, what it means is it doesn't realize the province-wide significance of what he allowed in the South Okanagan.
Yeah. What happened was, in final desperation, I contacted the president of the constituency association to try and get through to the minister to force some clarification about the implication of the Kelowna decision. And late last night, I got a phone call from that person saying that the same regulation as is applied in Kelowna would be approved for Surrey.
Last night.
And
you get this from a social credit party person.
Well, I asked for, because I wanted to talk to the minister to get some clarification about whether he intended to apply that to other districts, and I couldn't reach him, so I phoned him just in order to get the message.
Might you now be able to withdraw these notices hand-delivered by the superintendents today?
Well, we'll have to get some further clarification about that, of course, because this simply was a phone message, and I have no written confirmation of this.
Now, yours is a district which has got more and more students this year. How many more?
1,000 students more. Now, I must say that one phone call we did get from the minister's office on Friday, that the minister is prepared to meet with us on the 27th, a week today, to discuss the implications of the enrollment increase. Because it's a ludicrous situation for us that we are having to cut back and in the same time are growing rapidly.
Now, you've got 31,000 students in Surrey and
at this present time.
And 2,500 staff. How much did you have to cut altogether?
We're having to cut 2.2 million this time around.
What have you cut, apart from anything else?
We have cut approximately 1,300,000 out of other accounts. I wouldn't call them strictly non-salary. We've cut about a quarter of a million in the substitute budget. We've cut drastically in our equipment replacement and supply budget. I think the children may have to write 10 times on the same sheet of paper. And we can't, really we're cutting into the bone. We have nowhere to cut, but we do it anyway. We've cut in already the first time of the restraint. We've cut into field trips and into
Any classroom, any learning assistance cuts?
No, I couldn't say learning assistance cuts other than in...
How much are you going to have to cut by the end of 1983?
Well, it will be phenomenal. And, of course, at this moment, we are all taking stopgap measures because it's not going to help us in the next year anyway. But it buys us time.
Your 90 temporary teachers, these aren't substitutes.
Yeah.
90. These were temporary teachers who were given notice today.
They're teachers on temporary contracts who have had been given notice in June that they could had a job for this school year. We already in the spring did not renew contracts for temporary teachers, 21 temporary teachers. We already had cut 25 new positions we had originally budgeted for to meet enrollment increases, because at that time the housing slump might indicate that perhaps the growth wouldn't take place. So now we are really short.
I want to take my break now and come back to John Taylor from District 43.
The minister has made is going to affect a decision we have made to try to deal with the decree that he made, and which one with which we disagree very strongly. Inasmuch as we had put before our teachers a plan which, if they were prepared to give up one professional day in terms of salary but work that day, that we would be able to make the cuts, having to make also some very significant cuts in other areas that would affect, in our view, the quality of education in our district. It was our opinions, and I think the board felt unanimously, that the teachers would do that because they felt, saw us being fair, they saw us trying to cooperate with them. Now we have a minister who has interjected a new aspect into the program, and obviously our teachers are going to consider that. Also of concern to our board and myself personally, I think some of the other trustees have expressed this, in addition to everything else, the confrontative way in which the minister deals with this issue, teachers, school trustees, everyone in the educational system, is simply souring the process. 2 days after we made our decision and called upon the teachers to cooperate with us, and we generally, I think, got a good response, the minister made a threat, which was broadly interpreted, and I think fairly interpreted, as being a threat to teachers that they would lose their jobs if they took certain positions. That, in our view, is not very helpful, and that does not assist in the process of education.
You're saying that if any teachers walked out and went on strike for any appreciable time, he would find people to do the job. In other words, he'd fire them.
Yes, that's correct.
And you had actually asked the teachers to work one free day in October the 8th, and they would probably have quietly walked away for that.
Well, it was our view that having dealt with a difficult position that was placed upon us by the minister with absolutely no chance for timing in the worst possible way, that we had arrived at a formula which would show the teachers that we had done everything we could to consider their position and ask them to assist. I'm satisfied they would. They may still well, because they're people, generally, despite the attitude of people in the public, they're concerned about education and they're people of good judgment.
But now you can go back over and you can take this, you can put them out now for 5 days and you don't have to pay them and you can close the schools. Am I right in the intent of what he's done in Okanagan?
What he's done in Okanagan is he's reversed his original position where he said the system cannot be shut down. By allowing South Okanagan to use their non-instructional days, they can shut the system down.
And that'll save 5 days teachers' wages?
5 days teachers' wages. Also, the salaries of our
QP, administrators,
right.
Everybody.
Heat, light, all the rest of it.
Now, you're going to have to change your method of cutting a coat according to your cloth for this year.
Well, of course, one of the problems is, and this has been a problem all the way through, and that the BCSTA executive has tried to point out to the minister, is that we don't know the rules from day to day. They change from day to day, and as we find this morning, practically hour to hour sometimes. We in our district have made a sensible plan and tried to deal with a very, very, in our view, a very unwise restraint program by the government. We've attempted to do it, we think we've done it, and the rules have changed. The minister has said this morning that he wants input from us. We've been waiting for some sensible legislation and sensible comment from him so we can deal with it. We've tried to do that in our district, and now we're faced with another set of rules.
Okay, just broadly speaking on yours, how many pupils in 43?
There are about 22,000 pupils.
22,000. You're rising or dropping?
Ours is nominally dropping at this time, but it'll probably be rising in 2 or 3 years, so you have to consider that as well.
Now, you've cut the usual ones on supplies, outdoor education, field trips, all
that's
standard
correct.
Tubes.
That's
what
correct.
About classrooms? What are you cutting classrooms?
Well, effectively, when you cut substitute days, as many districts have done, when you don't rehire teachers that you plan to hire, cause them to be laid off through attrition, it affects the size of your class. There's no other way that you can't. It affects, indirectly, children with learning disabilities, because as you have to deal with a renewed formula, it means there's less teachers to go around. That means less for children with learning disabilities as well.
But you'd be the first to admit that the system was too fat and sassy and needed some trimming,
well,
didn't it?
Mr. Webster, you know, one man's fat is another man's necessity. If we had an observer from the third world here today, he would probably say, gee, you got a lot of fat in the system. You and I wouldn't agree with that because we have a different perspective. The important thing that in Coquitlam that we're really outraged at, and I think stronger than some other districts we've said this, we've said an important principle in governance of school districts is local input. We have made some local decisions on behalf of our electorate about the quality of education and the level of funding that we're prepared to pay in Coquitlam. The minister has arbitrarily said now, effectively said, well, you may want that, but I don't want that. I think it's important for people to consider that if they want to control education, they better be concerned that they can have a chance in an election to affect a person like myself by their vote. They sure won't be able to touch Mr. Vander's then. And in our district, we've also had to cut such things as speech therapists.
Well, I wanted to ask about that. Speech therapists, surely that's one of the things you should not be cutting.
Of course it isn't, and other areas that we dealt with are areas that we shouldn't cut as well, but you simply are forced into making...
Give me some of the other areas you've actually cut there.
Well, we've had to cut in substitute teacher days, as many other teachers. We did not hire a substantial number of teacher's aides that we had intended to hire, and that would have affected all educational courses, but including special education courses. We've had a drastic cut in supplies, basically put a freeze on supplies. Again, the other trustees have enumerated the sort of things that includes. All transportation grants have been cut drastically. That includes visits to outside resources in terms of education, fairs, science exhibits. Extramural sports has basically been gutted. And again, there's an example for Mr. Webster. Some people would consider that a frill. But for those of you who in your years in public school have taken part in extramural sports, you know that's an important part of your development. And in our district, that's going to be substantially affected. Janitorial positions haven't been filled. Over $500,000 in maintenance projects have simply been frozen. Next year, it's going to be more costly to do those. We're going to have to do them. But the minister in the middle of the year has required us to make cuts at this time.
I think that's what we should stress at the moment, that the cuts, the first lot of cuts were $28 million for 82. The second lot of cuts were $37 million for 82. And then in 83, you've got another $55 million to cut.
That's right.
Does that mean you won't get the benefit of even the 6 and 5?
We won't get the benefit of the 6 and 5 because we're going to go into a minus quantity. We're going to go minus 6% in 1983. So we're not even freezing. We're not even going to be able to say, hey, we have the same kind of dollars in 83 as we had in 82. It's minus 6% for education.
Now I'm going to have a panel of trustees to take your questions on Vander Zalm and the school cuts after the break. I'm going to take calls now on what's happening to your children in school and what's happening to your tax money and all the rest of it. And we know one of the new policies of Mr. Vander Zalm enunciated again this morning. Now I'm going to go to phones. With me I've got Dr. Buckley from Central Okanagan, Gary Bajan from BC School Trustees Association, Marjorie Stewart from Nanaimo, and Phillip Rankin from Vancouver. Go ahead, please.
Hello, Jack?
Yes, speak up.
Yes, I just wanted to say, first of all, that I don't like to see layoffs anywhere because I'm in the mining industry. But these teachers that are worried about the children, are these the same teachers that when the North was screaming for teachers, they didn't want to go up north because it wasn't the best place to work?
Hardly on the topic.
I've got a solution to the problem.
What's the problem?
What if the teachers didn't take pay for non-statutory days during the Christmas holidays?
What's he talking about? No, you don't make any sense to me. Go ahead, please.
Oh, hi, Jack.
Yeah.
I wonder if the trustees are aware that when teachers were given non-instructional days, the school year was expanded. That's the first question. That teachers do work those days right now without pay because when the school year was expanded, no extra pay was given.
Okay, who can answer that?
They don't work without pay totally because with the expansion of the school year, there's an expansion upward of the salary grid to accommodate the extra day's work.
Well, that's not correct.
Well, let's not argue about it. He says yes, you say no. Next question.
The next question is, with Mr. Vander Zalm's proposal today covers up till the end of 1982. In 1983, where much bigger cuts are to take place and all the fat has been cut, isn't it true that most of the cuts in 1983 will be from staffing.
That's right. 1983, we're going to have to focus on staffing because basically all we've done is band-aided our way through 1982 to buy us the time to look at 83 in a rational way.
So we're agreed on that, sir. Thank you. That comes through loud and clear, doesn't it? The next year's cuts, which have already been predicated, are going to mean throats.
I call it a shrunken system. There will be a shrunken public school system next year.
Go ahead, please.
Hello.
Yep.
Yeah, I just watching this, it looks like a lot of other things that are happening, not just in this province, but all across the country, like it's utter confusion. Like there's been no consensus. If the school board could get together and the trustees, the Minister of Education, instead of waiting till something has developed like this, where they turn around and make some kind of a decision, the Minister of Education then turns around and changes it or gives priority to a certain part of the province, it all looks ridiculous. I believe the time has come where everyone should get together, get their heads together, and straighten this mess out.
Well, maybe that's the fault of you trustees. Maybe it's the fault of the trustees.
This minister's never wanted to get together with anyone. The first or the other minister, they announced a $2.1 million cutback in Vancouver. We revised our budget. 30 days later, they announced a $4.5 million cutback. Now we find out that it's the next year it's going to be more like a $120 million cutback through the province. So what is it costing us to revise our budget? We're spending all our time now on budget revisions.
Yeah, but there's no need of it. If
no need of it. But if he doesn't do it, who's going to call them together?
I think that you have to understand that former Minister Brian Smith on July the 30th made the announcements of the budget cuts. 7 days later, he was no longer the minister.
That's right.
We had a new minister.
To me, if they want to do restraint, some restraint, they should do it in Victoria.
Okay, Brian, go ahead from Seashells.
Good morning.
Morning.
Would it be possible at all for Mr. Vander Zalm to take advantage of Mr. Fryer's offer of the $65 million? That he wanted to give to the industry. Thank you, Mr. Webster.
That was quite a morning when we had to try it on about that. Go ahead from Nanaimo.
Yes, I have some problem with terminology that's being used. Layoffs mean terminations. To me, restraint means controlling, checking, holding back, and restraint to do with education in 83 is a cutback. Mr. Bejan talks about 6% cutback from 82, but that doesn't figure in the inflation that the boards are going to have to pay in certain areas. But damn it, when you say restraint, to me that means holding back, keeping from growing too quickly. Mm-hmm. And restraint isn't what Mr. Vander Zalm has in mind. He means gutting the system. He means cutting back from what we've had. And I think that's what should be used instead of restraint.
Moved second and carried that the word shrunken is not strong enough.
Unanimous.
Agreed.
Unanimous.
We agree.
He has a problem, though, hasn't he?
Right.
I mean, the revenues are down, thousands are out of work, 219,000 people drawing unemployment insurance. They had to do something, didn't they?
Well, they got this billion-dollar mortgage scheme. I don't know where they're coming up with that money.
$1 billion, $4 million total, go from $50 million to $1
billion. Did they have to do everything in education? We've been told that phase two applies only to education.
Of the cuts?
Yes.
I can't think of phase two in anything else at the moment.
We haven't heard of anything.
There must be a phase two in the doctors next year, I suppose, of surrender.
No, next year is phase three.
Oh, I see. This year, you're the only people with phase two.
That's right.
The money is being taken from us.
Yeah, municipalities have been told that their budgets can go up in 1983 to a smaller extent. I think it's 5%. They have a growth factor in theirs.
But you have no growth factor.
No growth.
You have
it's a minus quantity. That's right.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, Jack. I think that the minister is just playing politics with the education of our children. Now, he says it's a simple solution if the trustees and that want to look at it. I think the simple solution is give the kids an extra week's holiday at Christmas or before their summer vacation, and that way I think the biggest part of the money would be saved in wages.
Just as a matter of common sense, would that have worked?
Yes, it would. It would have found the bulk of the money throughout British Columbia. It also would have assisted in another way, that up north in the cold weather parts of this province, it would have saved a great deal of money in terms of heat, light, and those kinds of expenses. And so maybe the government should be looking at it in a rational way by saying there's times in our calendar year when it's okay to shut the system down, and in the warmer period, then the system is open.
But it wouldn't have suited any political objectives he had, would it?
I guess not, because the simple solution has been rejected and ignored from the beginning. until Friday.
The political objective is to get rid of local school boards. That's what I think one of the objectives is. And this year, they've done more to remove local autonomy for school districts than any other year I can think of in the last decade.
You're not suggesting that the secret social credit plan is to run education directly from Victoria, are you?
No, I think it's similar to the county system, which has been proposed. It's all links together. It's the attack on local control, local political control.
We're getting to the central problem in the issue. The School Act assigns certain responsibilities to local boards of school trustees. These are competent groups of people who have shown on this program that they have the ability to do the planning necessary to carry out these functions. The difficulty is the minister insists on inserting himself into that process and overruling the best plans of a local school board. That will, by default, ruin and destroy the credibility of local boards and lead to their eventual destruction.
Go ahead, please. Hello. Somebody hung up on me. Go ahead, please. Hello. Where are you?
Jack, is this me?
That's you.
Seems to me that school teachers are wearing blinkers and that they're going to have to be dragged kicking and screaming into the realities of present-day economics. I have an idea that we're going to have to change the school system to some degree, and maybe volunteers from the public sector, keep alive special helps, and other non-basic activities might be the answer. In other words, the public, you know, you just can't depend on the taxpayer all the time. Things have changed. Parents want their sports and this, that, the other, they're going to have to get involved.
But parents have also said that they want the school system to provide more. And this is one of the things that trustees have to wrestle with, is the demands of society.
Everybody wants more.
Far be it from me to inject a nasty note, but don't forget that it's not always total goodwill about the school system. You are the teachers. As I recall, your average increase last year was a handsome gallus 17.3% plus your 3% increments for the teachers who hadn't yet reached the 12-year level. And it would seem that in today's very tough economic time, the teachers have been doing very well, thank you very much, compared to other workers in the economy, haven't they?
Without dragging it into it, the average two-year increase in the public sector was 31%. The average two-year increase for teachers is 30%. And when you have an arbitration system like we have, where you don't have the right to strike in the province, where we can't lock out our teachers, then you're going to get these kind of settlements because there's no collective bargaining process.
But the time comes, as you well know, when the forest industry is closed down, the pulp industry is going to hell in a handbasket. You've got ordinary people outside who say, why should all these public servants be maintained with fancy increases when we're suffering?
Mm-hmm. But the time is not August of the year when you're three quarters of the way through the contract year. The time is January 1st to give a zero increase to teachers and solve your problem. It's problem solving we're looking for, not political difficulties.
And allow the collective bargaining system to decide. And that's what you'll see for 83.
Yeah, no doubt about that. My thanks to Dr. Buckley from Central Okanagan, Gary Bajan from B.C.S.T.A., Marjorie Stewart from Nanaimo, Phillip Rankin from Vancouver, and I'm going to bring in four other trustees to finish the program. Remember, even with the new Vander Zalm adjustment this morning about the no pay for and no professional days, that this is the first and second phases of the cuts for 1982. There are two more phases and cuts for 1983. And on my right, I've got Mark Sager from West Van. I've got Marion
Williams
from Powell River, Louise Sorensen from Surrey, and John Taylor from District 43, Coquitlam. And we're going to take phone calls to them now, too. Where am I going? Go ahead to the trustees,
Jack,
please. Yeah.
Yeah, what I'd like to ask you is, I'm in one of the unemployed teachers, and what I'd like to ask you is what you consider as being fat on the budget. For example, field trips and exchanges, I know, with the Richmond system, with the exchanges with Japan and that. I see that as all being very educational with the kids.
Well, sometimes,
and I cannot understand what your ideas of budget.
First of all, I think that the school boards have been far too heavy and highly placed administrators, many of whom were teachers who should have been in the classrooms.
Uh-huh.
Secondly, sometimes you can afford a trip to Hawaii and sometimes you can't afford a trip to Hawaii. Sometimes I think, too, the aides have been overdone and the teachers have been given a little bit too much leeway. Sometimes
Oh, I can go on forever about it.
So that hasn't been an assistance to the students at all? Of course, it's
a question of what can you afford. It's a question of how much money you've got. It's a question of what priorities you put on education and how much money you're going to spend on education. I can think of half a dozen government programs where money is tittled down the drain. Pharmacare, for instance, refunds go back to many people who don't need the money at all. And there are many universal programs which one of these days in our whole social system are going to have to be applied on the basis of a means test. But at the moment, they're universal. Now, what else could I say? I don't think all teachers are good. I think once a teacher gets into the system, he's safe for life unless he commits some ghastly act on the steps of the school at high noon in the presence of two sober, straightforward police officers. They're protected too much. But half as protected as university professors, most of whom should be dumped. That's an exaggeration. Go ahead, please. Go ahead, please. Where are you?
Hello?
That's you.
Hello, Jack.
Yeah.
Yes, I sympathize with the school teachers. It's taken them as long to learn their craft as it does the doctor to learn his. I think I have a solution to all this situation with money and cutbacks. Why doesn't the federal government send the children to school for 6 months, and then the other 6 months, send them over to Van der Zandt's house to have a ball?
Thank you very much. Flip remark. Not even funny. Go ahead, please.
Hello, Jack.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd like a reserve comment on your university, Professor Crack, for a second. But my main question was on that budget, in that I don't know if they've taken into account that the evolutionary spiral is going to punch things up a good 10% next year anyway. So on your non-contractual obligations, you're going to be looking at 16% cuts.
What would you say to them? What kind of cuts do you expect to anticipate next year on the Van der Zandt program?
Well, first of all, in West Vancouver, perhaps we haven't seen the direct mandate yet. It hasn't arrived in any written form as yet. We've only heard numbers bandied about.
Right.
Talking about inflation for 1983, I don't think there's going to be any inflation for 1983 if things continue the way they're going. What do you think?
I don't know.
It seems to me, Jack, that the problem is that we have no direction whatsoever about how to plan for 83, and it's absolutely impossible to even foresee what's going to happen. Certainly, of course, for Surrey, it's a.
But you're not going to get an inflationary increase in your budget of even 6% next year.
No, it's going to be negative. It's going to be negative. So more that the gentleman is the caller is right. More of the non-salary money is going to go in the non-salary account to make up for, even if there isn't much inflation, things that have already gone up. Workers' compensation, and looks like the medical plan, all the sharing that we have with that is going to go up a great deal. Dental plan, the indication is that it's going to go up.
And then, of course, you'll have essential repairs and maintenance, which you're skipping this year, which you must do next year, have you not?
That's correct. That's right. Should add the one caution, though, that I suppose it is possible yet that the minister and his government will listen to the people, and if people indicate to the government that their priorities are different than the government's, and if I'm correct in my assumption that local taxpayers who, let's remember, pay most of the cost of education, and who, let's remember, also have this year already paid the money, the government hasn't offered them anything back, that those people have to be consulted, and I, as a school trustee, my mandate is to talk to those people, and if they tell me that as a community we're prepared to pay for education, it seems to me our role as trustees is to argue that with the government, mm-hmm. Tell them that the taxpayers' priorities are different than theirs.
Mind you, the taxpayers' priorities these days are to keep the cost down. So many of them are in trouble. Wouldn't you agree?
Well, that's true, but keep in mind again that the local taxpayers have paid their educational taxes. They're not getting any of it back. They're not seeing any benefit from Mr. Vander Zandt's doing.
Well, now, that's just 2 seconds, though, because let's remember, it's all of us. We're all taxpayers, and certainly if it's saved out of the provincial revenue or saved out of the local level, it's our money. Mm-hmm. Let's remember that.
You can get into discussion about consolidated revenue, but when you talk about school taxes, the acts are set out so that local taxpayers pay by far the large majority of taxes directly as a school tax. They pay it to pay for schools, not to pay for transpos, not to pay for stadiums, not to pay for Northeast
Coast. But many of them resent the level of school taxes, don't they? Especially in West Vancouver, where you've got no kids and all kinds of taxes.
Some of them do, Jack, but the point is, and again, the point I try to make, and I think is important, is those people, as it stands now, will have a chance to make that opinion known locally this November with their school trustees. They can't affect Mr. Vander Zalm's judgment one whit.
Go ahead, please.
Yes. We have run a business, and these trustees are saying that if they had known last spring what money they had to operate and so on with, it's about time they started running it like a business. We have a business. Nobody told us last year when we had to sign an 18.75% mortgage that this fall we were going to have empty apartments, we were going to have to lower our rents and so on. We've had to cut back, too. We can't cut back in our services, but our cutback is in our pocketbook.
Now, that's a very good point, isn't it?
Well, that's what I mentioned earlier, though, isn't it? I said, you know, there's simply no way that the government could know back in January that the revenues are going to be as they are now. And
they don't have the money coming in from businesses that are no longer there, what are they going to do?
Precisely.
Mr. Webster, but...
Louise?
My concern is not that, that is not the issue. The issue is that how that cutback is being handled and the lack of direction that is given and the lack of support to school boards to implement. I'd like to just say the minister quoted Erasmus in his address to the school trustees. I'd like him to know that the title of the book of Erasmus is In Praise of Folly. And I think we...
There we must leave it. My thanks to Mark Sega from West Vancouver, Marion Palmer from Marion Williams from Powell River, Louise Sorensen from Coquitlam, and from Surrey, and John Taylor from Coquitlam.
Thank you.
I'll be back after a bit. Following the BCGEU strike tomorrow, Sima Holt's coming in, the other Mrs. Diefenbaker, and Sven Robinson on all these new laws that he's managed to hammer through in Ottawa. What else? Don't really know. We're off to another good week, though, I'll tell you that. And I'll be back with Webster tomorrow at 9 a.m. precisely. Gutting a BC school system on check at midnight.